those who worship the Lord, worship in spirit and truth. Those who say that they know Him must walk as He walked. Those who worship the Lord, worship in spirit and truth. Those who say that they know Him must walk as He walked. He is the way and the truth, and in Him ends the life. If we obey His word, then we walk in the light.
So the man went, washed his face, and came back, seeing. His neighbors then, and the people who had seen him begging before this, asked, "Isn't this the man who used to sit and beg?"
"He's the one."
"No, he isn't. He just looks like him. I am the man. How is it that you can now see?"
"The man called Jesus made some mud, rubbed it on my eyes, and told me to go to Siloam and wash my face. So I went, and as soon as I washed, I could see."
"Where is he?"
"I don't know."
Then they took to the Pharisees the man who had been blind. The day that Jesus made the mud and cured him of his blindness was a Sabbath. Pharisees then asked the man again how he had received his sight.
"He put some mud on my eyes. I washed my face, and now I can see."
"A man who did this cannot be from God, for he does not obey the Sabbath law. How could a man who is a sinner perform such miracles as these?"
And there was division among them.
"You say he cured you of your blindness. Well, what do you say about him?"
"He is a prophet."
The Jewish authorities, however, were not willing to believe that he had been blind and could now see until they called his parents.
"Is this your son? You say that he was born blind. How is it then that he can now see?"
"We know that he is our son, and we know that he was born blind. But We don't know how it is that he is now able to see, nor do we know who cured him of his blindness.
Ask him. He is old enough and he can answer for himself.
His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jewish authorities, who had already agreed that anyone who said he believed that Jesus was the Messiah would be expelled from the synagogue. That is why his parents said, "He is old enough, ask him." A second time, they called back the man who had been born blind.
Promise before God that you will tell the truth. We know that this man who cured you is a sinner.
I do not know if he is a sinner or not. One thing I do know. I was blind. And now I see.
What did he do to you? How did he cure you of your blindness?
I have already told you and you would not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Maybe you too would like to be his disciples.
They insulted him and said,
"You are that fellow's disciple. But we are Moses' disciples. We know that God spoke to Moses. As for that fellow, however, we do not even know where he comes from."
What a strange thing that is. You do not know where he comes from, but he cured me of my blindness. We know that God does not listen to sinners. He does listen to people who respect him and do what he wants them to do. Since the beginning of the world, nobody has ever heard of anyone giving sight to a person born blind. Unless this man came from God, he would not be able to do a thing.
You were born and brought up in sin. And you are trying to teach us.
And they expelled him from the synagogue.
All right, welcome back, friends, to our Bible study in the Gospel of John, chapter 9. And so we have entered into this healing after Jesus had left the temple, and he went down to the Pool of Siloam. We talked about where that was in the last video. I'm going to show a little bit on that of what's been found today archaeologically. But when he was going there, he passed by, it said, and there was a man who was born blind from his birth. And the disciples asked him, "Master, who did sin, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" Jesus said, "Neither had this man sinned, nor his parents, but that the works of God should be made manifest in him." Then he said, "I must work the works of him that sent me." We know that that's the Father. "While it is the day, the night comes when no man can work." And we know that Jesus was only going to be there for a short time. And there was going to come a day when night would come, when Jesus would be crucified and then obviously resurrected on the third day, appear to the disciples for 40 days and then ascend to heaven. So Jesus was going to be there temporarily, and he was transferring the Spirit of God onto these disciples who were going to follow in his steps when he left. And the Holy Spirit would be poured out on them on the day of Pentecost. He says, "As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." And we know that Jesus said in Matthew chapter 5 that you are the light of the world. "A city set on a hill cannot be hid, neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but they put it on a candlestick, and it giveth light to all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven." So Jesus is the light of the world when he was here, and now he shines his light through his disciples, through those who follow his Father, those who are born again. So we are the light of the world as born again believers, trusting in Jesus, being filled with the Holy Spirit. So we know that he spat on the ground after saying this. He made clay of the spittle, and he anointed the eyes of the blind man with the clay. And we know that this was illegal according to the Pharisaical, their oral Torah, their own law, not from the Lord himself, not from Mount Sinai, not from Moses, but their own laws said that you couldn't heal using spittle or saliva on a Sabbath day was considered work, or that you weren't allowed to make mud on the Sabbath day considered a violation according to their own personal interpretation. And we know that is nowhere in the law of Moses. So Jesus would always fly in the face of man-made ma'asim and takanot, they would call them, the ordinances that come from man. The Pharisees would develop their own interpretations, their own man-made laws, and then those would eventually supersede God's laws that he gave them. So we know that's not right, and Jesus was working on the Sabbath because he saw his Father working. And it's always right to do good on the Sabbath day, and Jesus would heal on the Sabbath day. And this irked these Pharisees. So this is causing a great stir. He tells them to go and wash in the pool of Siloam, which is by interpretation sent, and he went his way therefore and washed and came seeing. So that's where we left off. And this pool of Siloam is used quite a bit in history in the celebration of the Jewish feast of Sukkot or the Feast of Tabernacles. And it says of it, so of all places, an ancient pool in Jerusalem helps us connect Sukkot with its ultimate fulfillment. A statement made by Jesus, really an invitation, makes it clear. So Sukkot is the Feast of Tabernacles. Sukkot marked the most joyful of the biblical feasts because the harvest labors finally ceased in gratitude to the Lord for his provision. The people would begin their hope for the latter rains. In addition to the name Sukkot, translated booths or tabernacles in Deuteronomy 16:13 and Leviticus 23:34, the Bible also refers to the holiday as the Feast of the Harvest in Exodus 23:16, the Feast of Ingathering in Exodus 34:22, or the Feast in 1 Kings 8:2, 2 Chronicles 7:8-9, and John 7:37. And if you remember from John 7:37, Jesus cried out, saying to them, "If any man thirst, let him come unto me," and I'm pulling it up so I get it right. "If any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believes on me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water," which this was significant or signifying the Holy Spirit that had not yet been given. All right, so it was going back to Sukkot, and it was also called the Feast of the Lord in Leviticus 23:39. So at Sukkot, every 7 years on the sabbatical year, or the year of rest, the law was read in the hearing of all Israel, Deuteronomy 31:10-11. So it wasn't read every year, but on the seventh sabbatical year, the first five books were read. So the original purpose of feast centered on an essential reminder. It said in Leviticus, "Speak to the sons of Israel, saying, on the 15th of the seventh month is the Feast of Booths for 7 days to the Lord. You shall live in booths for 7 days. All the native born in Israel shall live in booths, so that your generations may know that I had the sons of Israel live in booths when I brought them out from the land of Egypt. I am the Lord your God." So that's Leviticus 23, 34, and verses 42 to 43. So Sukkot provided a time to remember how God had delivered his people from bondage and how he had provided for them in the wilderness. There's some more notes here I'm reading from Bible.org. And every year in modern Jerusalem, Sukkot draws hundreds of thousands of worshipers to the Western Wall, all holding the four species in their hands. There's four species they mention here. During the Second Temple period, the Sadducees understood the Bible's command to take branches of leafy trees and willows, Leviticus 23:40, as the building materials for their booths. The Pharisees, on the other hand, interpreted the foliage as what the worshipers would carry in their hands. Jews observe both customs today, and the Mishnah describes in exacting detail how they should construct their booths. The rabbis identified the fruit of Leviticus 23:40 as the etrog, a citron, which the worshiper would carry in the left hand. The right hand would hold three species of branches, the palm, the willow, and the myrtle. Every year in Jerusalem, modern Jerusalem, Sukkot draws hundreds of thousands of worshipers to the Western Wall, all holding the four species in their hands. Okay, so Sukkot and the Pool of Siloam. So in addition, the Feast of Tabernacles required sacrifices of sin offerings and burnt offerings at the time of preparation for the morning sacrifice. A priest would descend to the Pool of Siloam amidst great music, celebration, and singing of Isaiah 12:3, which says, "Joyfully you will draw water from the springs of deliverance." And he will fill a golden pitcher with water. After dipping his pitcher in Siloam's water, the priest would return to the Temple Mount and pour the water into one of four silver basins by the altar. They would say, "Raise your hand." And the priest would shout to the people would shout to the priest, "Raise your hand," so that they could see he indeed poured the water into the basin. And now we have some pictures, but let's just read a little of this. For many years, the Pool of Siloam was thought to be the upper pool besides the exit of Hezekiah's tunnel. Discovered near the turn of the 20th century, this pool dates only to the 5th century AD. Workers accidentally discovered the true Pool of Siloam from the Second Temple period in 2004 while digging a sewer line. Archaeologists have uncovered only a portion of this lower pool, exposing the entire north side, more than 220 feet long. Tourists can visit there today. Anybody who has ever gone camping knows that we forego major conveniences to do so. The Feast of Tabernacles required similar sacrifices, and it remains a timeless reminder of the fact that everything we possess, both physically and spiritually, comes from God. All right, so in addition to looking backward at God's historical blessings on Israel, Sukkot looked ahead to the time when all nations will celebrate the Feast of Tabernacles in Jerusalem in honor of Israel's reigning Messiah, from Zechariah 14, verses 16 to 18. And, okay, so I think that's all I'll cover from that. There's some spiritual meaning, obviously. We're not going to go into all of that. So there is also some uncovering of the path that was used, that was to go between the temple and Sukkot, or to the temple and the Pool of Siloam. If you'll remember, the temple is up here, Mount Moriah, and the priests would go down to the Pool of Siloam right here. So they would walk. There's a special road that they would walk along. And that's what's been uncovered archaeologically. So there is, let's see if I can adjust this size. So this is the pilgrimage. So it's kind of a rendering, it looks like. And it looks like it's underground. So up here is the temple. And you can see this roadway that goes down here to the southern end. Where the Pool of Siloam is. And so that's the same picture. This is the entrance, the actual road from the Pool of Siloam to the Temple Mount. So you have to go underground. And this is a picture of him in, I don't know this man's name, but it's a picture of the actual walkway from the Pool of Siloam to the Temple Mount. He's just showing you a underground passage that's been uncovered. And this is the actual pool right here. And this is the actual, looks like the actual roadway right here, which is underground. Yeah, the actual road. And this is going all the way to the Temple Mount. This is the modern Temple Mount. And I'm not sure if this gangplank structure is part of that actual road. I think it probably is, to take you into the Temple Mount area. So here's another shot of the actual road. So anyway, I thought that was interesting. I had seen that recently, and I just wanted to show that they have uncovered that. They know now this was done on the Feast of Tabernacles, where the priest would walk down this road, get water in that golden basin, and he would take it back to the brazen altar, and he would pour it into one of four silver basins by the brazen altar during the feast. And this is the feast what we saw in John 7, where Jesus, during the pouring out of this water, said, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. So Jesus being the source, that picture, that water, is just a picture of Jesus being the living water. So anyway, that's the significance of this pool, just in case we want to draw any meaning out of it. And we go back to John 9:8 now, and let's look at where Jesus goes from here. So this man went and washed in verse 7, and he came back seeing, it says. He went his way therefore and washed, and came seeing. And then in verse 8 now, the neighbors therefore, and they which before had seen him that he was blind, said, is not this he that sat and begged? So the neighbors, this man seems to have been one who attracted considerable attention. The number of persons totally blind in any community usually is very small. Fortunately, when the Lord returns, I hope that to be zero. And it is possible that this was the only blind beggar in Jerusalem. So the case was one, therefore, likely to attract attention, and one where there could be no imposture, as he was generally known. Okay, so the next, in verse 9, some said, this is he. Others said, he is like him. But he said, I am he. Therefore said they unto him, how were thine eyes opened? He answered and said, a man that is called Jesus made clay and anointed my eyes, and said unto me, go to the pool of Siloam and wash. And I went and washed, and I received sight. Now notice, the pool is named Sent, and Jesus sends him to the pool Sent. So very meaningful. And so this miracle has quite a bit of meaning behind it. Then said they unto him, let's go back. I'm not sure I read all that. So he answered and said, a man that is called Jesus made clay and anointed my eyes, and said unto me, go to the pool of Siloam and wash. And I went and washed and received my sight. It's as simple as that. Okay, so verse 12. Then said they unto him, where is he? He said, I know not. So they brought to the Pharisees him that aforetime was blind. So when they say they brought him to the Pharisees or to the members of the Sanhedrin, they did this doubtless to accuse Jesus of having violated the Sabbath. This is their standard mode of operation. And it seems like violating the Sabbath seems to be one of the main offenses they try to capture him on. And then blasphemy is what they ultimately have him crucified, because he made himself to be the Son of God. Although true, they were closed-minded to him being Messiah. So they brought him there that they might accuse Jesus of having violated the Sabbath, and not as they ought to have done, to examine into the evidence that he was from God. Unfortunately, they didn't do an honest assessment as a good judge would. He would take all the facts, all the witnesses, all the testimonies, and then make his decision. But these judges were tainted. They already had made a judgment in their heart, so really the facts didn't matter. Verse 14 now. And it was the Sabbath day when Jesus made the clay and opened his eyes. Then again the Pharisees also asked him how he had received his sight. He said unto them, He put clay upon my eyes, and I washed and do see. So it's as simple as that. So the Pharisees asked him how. And the proper question to have been asked in the case was whether he had in fact done it, and not in what way that he had done it. The question also about a sinner's conversion is whether in fact it has been done, and not about the mode or manner in which it is effected. Yet it is remarkable that no small part of the disputes and inquiries among men are about the mode in which the Spirit renews the heart, and not about the evidence that it is done. That's an awesome point that Albert Barnes brings out. So they're kind of following a rabbit trail here. They're more interested in how it was done, because they're just, you know, how can this be? This must be miraculous. There's no natural means by which men see who are blind and do see. But yet they're unwilling to look at the fact that it had been done, and that it was a true transformation. In fact, they're more set on trying to disprove it, discredit Jesus, and not mark it as a notable miracle, so they don't have to ascribe to this being from God. So, you know, ask the secondary question, how was it done? Not the fact that it was done in this man's life is transformed. He was blind, now he can see. And that's how it is when a man or woman is born again. Why are they different? Why is their character different? What's happened to them? They used to act a certain way. They used to go to the clubs and the bars and get drunk. They had no problems with watching filthy, dirty movies. They had no problems using curse words and cuss words and swear words. Now they don't. Their language is clean. Now they don't look at the same movies they used to. Now they don't go out and get wasted on alcohol or high on drugs. And something's different about them. They're changing. They've been transformed. And it's happened pretty quick. Wow. You know, no, they're just more stunned that what has happened. How did this happen? Rather than the fact that this person's life has been transformed. And transformed by who? Transformed by Jesus, Messiah, who not only came for the Jew, but he came for the Gentile also. Hallelujah. So let's go to verse 16. So then again, the Pharisees also, therefore said some of the Pharisees, this man is not of God, because he keeps not the Sabbath day. Others said, how can a man that is a sinner do such miracles? And there was a division among them. So some of these people in the crowd are cluing in that, wait a minute, you Pharisees, you call him a Sabbath breaker, you call him a sinner, but yet he opened a man's eyes, which has never been seen by a man that has this healing gift. And I can't think of any in the Old Testament that received their sight. So, how can this be? You know, they're stunned, because this is truly a miracle. We all know that this man has been around. We're his neighbors. We know there aren't many blind people in Jerusalem. And we know this man was born blind as a baby. We knew him all the way up to where he's at right now. And I don't think it said the age of this man. But he is born blind, and it's a noted miracle here. So there's already a departure from the Pharisees' mantra that they're not doing an honest judgment, an honest assessment. So they say this man is not of God, or is not sent by God, or cannot be a friend of God. You know, they're just throwing out a blind accusation. Why do they say he can't be of God? Because he doesn't keep the Sabbath day. They assume that their views or interpretation of the Sabbath was correct, and it was the way that God would do it. And by those views, they judged others. So they looked through the Word of God through their own narrow interpretation and through their own filters. You know, they had their own rules that they wrote in interpretation to what God had given about the Sabbath day. They added on to what God had said. So they were putting men under yokes and bondages by this type of thing, and they were trying to hang this yoke on Jesus, saying, they, you know, we're the leaders in charge. We know what God is like. If you want to know about theology or a relationship with God, come to us. We've interpreted every law, and we've added our own interpretations. And what they did is they added their own laws that superseded God's law. And so they were judging others by these. And by these incorrect Ma'asim and Takanot, they judged others. So it did not occur to them to inquire whether the interpretation which they put on the law might not be erroneous. So that to me says they're functioning out of a heart of pride. Pride blinds, and they were unwilling to humble themselves and ask if their interpretation could have been incorrect. You know, men say, how could so many of us get it wrong? Right? And they would be blinded in thinking that they have a firm foundation to stand on because they feel that there's safety in numbers. But that's not true. God's way is, God's thoughts are higher than man's thoughts. God's ways are higher than our ways. As the sky or the stars are higher than the earth, so are God's thoughts and his ways higher than man's ways. So men often assume their own interpretations of the scriptures to be infallible and then judge and condemn all others by those interpretations. That's what we're seeing here. So they call him a sinner. What they mean is he's a deceiver, an imposter. They reasoned conclusively that God would not give the power of working such miracles to an imposter. The miracles were such as could not be denied. They were as plain as the nose on their faces. Nor did even the enemies of Jesus attempt to deny them or to explain them away. And that's something to note here. They're not even trying to explain the fact that, no, this man, he's still blind. You're deceived. No, they didn't even try to deny it. They're like, okay, yeah, we know he sees. This is undeniable. Undeniable. So we have to attack the man. If you can't attack the message, if you can't get around the truth, you attack the messenger. This is what's happening. So they couldn't explain them away. They were open, public, and frequent. And this shows that they could not deny their reality. Had it been possible, they would have done it. But the reality and power of those miracles had already made a party in favor of Jesus, even in the Sanhedrin. So look at this. Some of the members of the Sanhedrin were coming in line. Nicodemus, in John 7:50, it said of him, he that came to Jesus by night being one of them. Right? So, let's see here. Let's go back. I think this will explain it a little bit better. So in verse 48 of John 7, have any of the rulers or of the Pharisees believed on him? But this people who knows not the law are cursed. Nicodemus says unto them, he that came to Jesus by night being one of them. So he was one of them that believed on him. And the officers, they couldn't even arrest him. So the officers, when they came to the chief priests and Pharisees, and they said unto them, what, and the Pharisees and chief priests asked the officers why they didn't arrest him. The officers answered, never man spake like this man. And, you know, they in their pride said, are you deceived also? Have any of us religious big shots or the rulers or the Pharisees believed on him. But this people who knows not the law are cursed. You know, that's their pride. We know the law. You common people, you lay people, ignore your conscience, ignore the law of God written on your heart. We know it. You listen to us. We'll tell you what to believe. So, you know, Nicodemus in the following verse, he said, does our law judge any man before it hear him and know what he doeth? So, you know, Nicodemus was somewhat standing up for Jesus here because in his heart, he had already met with Jesus and was seeking him out in John chapter 3. And, you know, if I'm not mistaken, I think he even mentioned that. So he said, when he came in verse 2, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God, for no man can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him. So I believe Nicodemus really meant that there were some, they knew that he came from God because of the miracles, the undeniable miracles that he was doing. So, and he says that there's a we here. We know that thou art a teacher come from God. So there is a group here. Now, how many of them? Maybe most of them did, and they just were unwilling to deny to, or they are unwilling to believe it because they didn't want to lose their position or abandon their false doctrine, abandon what they understood God to be in their position and their lifestyle in a humbling process that made them afraid. It made them threatened. So to come to the Lord, we must be poor in spirit. We must be willing to humble ourselves. And then it's everything in the kingdom is available to us. So, and then there's John 12:42. Nevertheless, among the chief rulers, also many believed on him. But because of the Pharisees, they did not confess him, lest they should be put out of the synagogue. So there were many chief rulers who believed on him. But the Pharisees as a whole, the ones in control, were the ones making people afraid in direct opposition to Jesus. So those opposed to them could not deny their reality. Those opposed to the miracles of Jesus could not deny their reality. It may be added that the early opponents of Christianity never denied the reality of the miracles performed by the Savior and his apostles. Celsus, these are names, Celsus, Porphyry and Julian, as acute foes of the gospel as perhaps have ever lived, never call this in question. They attempted to show that it was by some evil influence or to account for the miracles in some other way than by admitting the divine origin of the Christian religion. But about the facts, they had no question. So they just tried to attack the origin of where these miracles came from, but the facts that they were done were settled. So were they not as well qualified to judge about those facts as men are now? They lived near the time, had every opportunity to examine the evidence, were skillful and talented disputants, and if they could have denied the reality of the miracles, they would have done it. It is scarcely possible to conceive of more conclusive proof that those miracles were really performed. And if so, then the Lord Jesus was sent by God. So there was no getting around it. These were undeniable proofs. Jesus was healing men. They had many, many witnesses. Many witnesses. And more than any court of law would ever require for the burden of proof in a modern day court. And it would be allowable evidence. And that is how things are proved. You have eyewitnesses who are willing to swear under oath is strong evidence. And if you have multiple, you know, the Bible says out of the two or three witnesses, the mouths of two or three witnesses, let that thing be established. But perhaps you had hundreds here. And they all knew this man. His neighbors were around. So there was a division. Obviously so. How can you violate your conscience? How can you violate what you know to be true? In the Greek, this word division means a schism. There was a schism. A separation into two parties. Okay, so we went through those. Now, verse 17. They said unto the blind man again, what sayest thou of him that he hath opened thine eyes? And this man responds, he's a prophet. We know he's more than a prophet. So they say, they ask him the question, what do you say of him? You know, what's your own testimony? Like, what does it matter what this man's opinion of him is, if he's a prophet or no? I just know that he performed this miracle on me. Perhaps he didn't, the blind man never even heard of Jesus, or he had heard of him but never even thought he'd ever meet him. You know, he couldn't travel far. He probably only went to a limited number of locations a day, and Jesus had to come to him. So he could only know what other men were talking about Jesus in hearsay. So let's see here. The translation here expresses the sense obscurely. The meaning is, what sayest thou of him for giving thee sight? That's from Campbell. Or what opinion of him hath this work of power and mercy to thee wrought in thee, Hammond said. So what's your opinion about this work of power? And he just sums it up simply. He says he's a prophet. That is, I think that the power to work such a miracle proves that he is sent from God. And though this has been done on the Sabbath, yet it proves that he must have been sent by God, for such a power could never have proceeded from man. Wow. So we see here, there's a couple things. First, a noble confession made by the man who was healed in the face of the rulers of the people. So there's no fear of man here. He's not caring. He's just telling the honest facts. And there should be no fear in just telling the honest facts. And when he doubtless knew that they were opposed to Jesus, so he said it even knowing these men were doubtless opposed to Jesus. So there could have been a fear of man here. But he did not cringe. He was bold in his confession. So we should never be ashamed before any class of men to acknowledge the favors which we have received from Christ and to express our belief of his power and of the truth of his doctrine. You know, Jesus said, if you know, fear not man which can kill the body and are not able to kill the soul, but rather fear him who is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. And he who would be ashamed of me and my words, of him also will I be ashamed when I come in the glory of my Father and with the holy angels. So we are to stand firm, not only for what Jesus said, but for what he's done in our lives. So the works of Jesus were such as to prove that he came from God, however much he may have appeared to oppose the previous notions of men, the interpretation of the law by the Pharisees, or the deductions of reason. So the works of Jesus were such as to prove that he came from God, period. No matter how he offended any notions of men, preconceived notions of men, false notions of men, false interpretations by the Pharisees of the law, or the deduction by reason of worldly men. So people should yield their own views of religion to the teachings of God. So we go to the Bible, the basic instruction before leaving earth, and we go to the word of God. Man doesn't live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. We are to, that is our food. His words are spirit and they are life. They are transforming. They transform our hearts. They transform our lives. We live by what God says. And that's how we yield our views, what we yield our views to. The entrance of his light, the entrance of his word brings light. We know God is light. And we know all light casts out, overcomes the darkness. Darkness cannot overcome the light. Light displaces darkness. So whenever we want more of God, God is light, we get more of his word. His word is light. and it displaces the darkness out of our hearts. And so that is what we base our opinions on. That is what we base our judgments on. If a man has committed a miracle or not, is it according to God's word and not a misinterpretation or false interpretation? You know, they're not even, they can't dispute the miracle, so they're going after a false notion or interpretation of the Sabbath law that these men have, trying to make Jesus look like a sinner rather than the true definition. He's a prophet, but he's more than a prophet. I mean, this man's low interpretation of Jesus, even though it's much higher than the leaders, is he came from God. He's sent from God. He's speaking for God as a prophet. So, people should yield their own views of religion to the teachings of God, to his word. Jesus is the word of God. That's his name. And believe that he that could open the eyes of the blind and raise the dead were fitted to declare his will. So that's just basic ABCs, 1, 2, 3s. Even a fifth grader should be able to interpret it that way. But our own filthiness in our hearts can lead us astray and would be blinded. These men were blinded. They weren't humble. They were proud. God opposes the proud. He gives grace to the humble. If they would have humbled themselves and drew nigh to God and cleansed their hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded, weep and mourn and be afflicted. Let your laughter be turned into mourning and your, how does that go? James 4:6. But he gives more grace. Wherefore he says, God resists the proud, but gives grace unto the humble. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Be afflicted, and mourn, and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning, and your joy to heaviness. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up. These men were at least falling to the sin of pride, and they were unwilling to humble themselves. But God would have lifted them up if they had humbled themselves to the truth that he did a miracle here and that only someone sent from God, not a sinner, could do this miracle. God does not hear the prayers of the sinner. If we regard iniquity in our hearts, God does not hear us. They should have known that from the Psalm of David. So the works of Jesus were such as to prove that he came from God. And however much he may have appeared to oppose the previous notions of men, people should yield their own views of religion to the teachings of God. We live by every word that proceeds out of his mouth. So let's go to the next few verses now. We go back to verse 18 now. But the Jews did not believe concerning him that he had been blind and received his sight, until they called the parents of him that had received his sight. So now they're calling for other witnesses. They don't like the witnesses, his neighbors, who had seen him. They weren't giving the right report that they wanted. Let's go all the way to the parents. If this man was born blind and his parents are available, let's call him in. We don't believe it. We don't believe he was blind. Only his parents would know. So they did not believe concerning this him that he had been blind and received his sight. And they called the parents of him that had received his sight. And they asked them, saying, is this your son who you say was born blind? How then doth he now see? Whoa. You know, now they're asking the parents who weren't even a witness to this. So all they can really testify to was if he was born blind or not. So is this your son? So the Pharisees proposed three questions to the parents by which they hoped to convict the man of falsehood. So, you know, you see the tainted judgment here. First, whether he was their son. Second, whether they would affirm that he was born blind. And third, whether they knew by what means he now saw. So they evidently intended to intimidate the parents so that they might give an answer to one of these questions that would convict the man of deception. We see here the art to which men will resort rather than admit the truth. Had they been half as much disposed to believe on Jesus as they were to disbelieve, there would have been no difficulty in the case. And so with all men. Were they as much inclined to embrace the truth as they are to reject it, there would soon be an end of all petty objections. And that's it. It's not the fact that because there's no openness to the truth, because it's as Romans 1 says, they resist the truth, they suppress the truth in unrighteousness. So they don't have an open heart to the truth. And that's what makes it hard, because you can't convince somebody who is not open. They close down, and no matter if you give them the raw truth, they will not embrace it. They will reject it because their mind is closed. So, and that's what Jesus also said, if you remember, in Matthew 13. The reason he spoke in parables, 13:13. In the Passion Translation, he says, "That's why I teach the people using parables, because they think they're looking for truth, yet because their hearts are unteachable, they never discover it. Although they will listen to me, they never fully perceive the message I speak." The prophecy of Isaiah describes them perfectly. "Although they listen carefully to everything I speak, they don't understand a thing I say. They look and pretend to see, but the eyes of their heart are closed." The eyes of their heart are closed. "Their minds are dull and slow to perceive. Their ears are plugged and are hard of hearing. And they have deliberately shut their eyes to the truth. Otherwise, they would open their eyes to see and open their ears to hear and open their minds to understand, and they would turn to me and let me instantly heal them." So you see, their minds are dull and slow to perceive. Their ears are plugged and hard of hearing. They deliberately shut their eyes to the truth. So they've, in the, if you go back a verse, "They pretend to see, but the eyes of their heart are closed." So they've closed themselves off to the truth. And so let's go back here. "They evidently intended to intimidate the parents so that they might give an answer to one of these questions that would convict the man of deception." We see here the art to which men will resort rather than admit the truth. Had they been half as much disposed to believe on Jesus as they were to disbelieve, there would have been no difficulty in the case. And so with all men, were they as much inclined to embrace the truth as they are to reject it, there would soon be an end of all petty objections. So just a repeat of what I read, but you can see, you know, this is why Jesus came teaching in parables, because, you know, hearing the truth has responsibility on it. And you know, you really have to have a heart for the truth, and those who diligently seek the truth will find it. So Jesus said that if you seek, you'll find. But if you don't have a true heart to want to do it, then, and you're not listening carefully, then you can walk away from a parable and not know the true heavenly meaning. So their hearts are closed, and now they're not held under that accountability because they haven't understood. But yet they're still guilty before God. Okay, verse 20. "So his parents answered them and said, 'We know that this is our son and that he was born blind.'" "But by what means he now sees, we know not. Or who hath opened his ears, we know not. He is of age, ask him. He shall speak for himself." These words spake his parents because they feared the Jews, for the Jews had agreed already that if any man did confess that he was Christ, he should be put out of the synagogue. So his parents answered them and said that we know that this is our son and that he was born blind. So to the first two questions, they answered without hesitation. They knew that he was their son and that he was born blind. The third question they could not positively answer, as they had not witnessed the means of the cure and were afraid to express their belief. So it appears that they had themselves no doubt, but they were not eyewitnesses and could not be therefore legal evidence. So they could only testify to the fact that he was our son and that he was born blind. So now they say, so they couldn't answer the question by what means he does see. We know not. And then they said that he is of age in this verse, in verse 21. He is of age. He is of sufficient age to give testimony among the Jews. This age was fixed at 13 years. So he was at least that age or older. So if any man did confess, so they were afraid, if any man did confess that he was the Christ, they were going to be thrown out of the synagogue. So did they, meaning if any man did confess what? That he was the Christ or the Messiah, or acknowledge that Jesus was Messiah. They had prejudged the case and were determined to put down all free inquiry and not to be convinced by any means. So this was a corrupt court, and they were going to be put out of the synagogue. There was, you know, this is the threat, put out of the synagogue, castaways of their own community. And this took place in the temple or near the temple. It does not refer, therefore, to any immediate and violent putting forth from the place where they were. It refers to excommunication from the synagogue. So they're no longer allowed to attend the synagogue on the Sabbath. Among the Jews, there were two grades of excommunication, the one for lighter offenses, of which they mentioned 24 causes, the other for greater offenses. The first excluded a man for 30 days from the privilege of entering a synagogue and from coming nearer to his wife or friends than 4 cubits. Ouch. So you were separated not only from the synagogue, but from your own wife and your friends. You couldn't come within 4 cubits of their persons. So almost like a restraining order. The other was a solemn exclusion forever from the worship of the synagogue, attended with awful maledictions and curses, and an exclusion from all contact with the people. You know, this is interesting because I've heard a testimony of someone who was an Orthodox Jew, converted to become a Christian, was born again. He actually had a physical encounter, or an encounter with the Lord. He was very, very ardent, opposed to Christianity and, you know, to the Gentiles and so forth. But he had a supernatural conversion, which all new births are. Being born again is very supernatural. And he couldn't come near his wife anymore. You know, the community was so strict on him. He was basically treated as a dead man. And he basically was excommunicated. So this goes on in modern day Judaism. And so you lose contact with the people. This was called the curse, and so thoroughly excluded the person from all communion whatever with his countrymen that they were not allowed to sell to him anything, even the necessities of life. It is probable that this latter punishment was what they intended to inflict if anyone should confess that Jesus was the Messiah. And that still goes on today, friends, unfortunately, according to this man's testimony. And it was the fear of this terrible punishment that deterred his parents from expressing their opinion. Okay. All right, so now verse 23. Therefore said his parents, he is of age, ask him. Then again called they the man that was blind and said unto him, give God the praise. We know that this man is a sinner. So give God the praise. This expression seems to be a form of administering an oath. It is used in Joshua 7:19, where Joshua said unto Achan, my son, give, I pray thee, glory to the Lord God of Israel, and make confession unto him, and tell me now what thou hast done. Hide it not from me. So Achan had stolen the silver and the treasure from Jericho, I believe. And he hid it, when he wasn't supposed to, and then he was ultimately executed for this punishment. So this is where this expression, give God the praise, comes from. And my son, give, I pray thee, glory. Oh, so yeah, so this is when Achan was put on his oath and entreated to confess his guilt. Joshua said, my son, give, I pray thee, glory to the Lord God of Israel. In the Greek or the Septuagint version, the very expression used in John, give God the praise, it says, and make confession unto him. So it is equivalent to an adjuration in the presence of God to acknowledge the truth. So it's like a confession under an oath, as the truth would be giving God praise, confessing the case before him and trusting to his mercy. So let's look at a comparison with 1 Samuel 6:5, where it says, wherefore ye shall make images of your emerods and images of your mice that mar the land, and ye shall give glory unto the God of Israel. Perhaps he will lighten his hand from off you and from off your gods and from off your land. So you compare this to Jonah 9:18. John 9:18. But the Jews did not believe concerning him that he had been blind and received his sight, until they called his parents of him that had received his sight. So let's see here. No, we don't want to compare those verses. It says, compare 1 Samuel 6:5. The meaning here is not give God praise for healing you, for they were not willing to admit that he had been cured, as we see in John 9:19. All right, so they were not willing to admit that he had been blind and received. So they were not willing to admit that he was born blind, is what he's saying here. But they wanted him to confess that there is imposture in the case, that you have been declared to us a falsehood. So really, you weren't born blind. We know that you see now, but you weren't born blind. So there must have been some falsehood that's being represented to us, that you have endeavored to impose on us, and by thus confessing your sin, give praise and honor to God, who condemns all imposture and falsehood, and whom you will thus acknowledge to be right in your condemnation. So admit your sin for not being born blind. So they wanted him to lie to go along with the story, the judgment that the Pharisees already had in their hearts. And they were trying to say, give praise to God for healing you and confess your sin, because we're not willing to believe you were born blind. But they had every witness saying that he was, even up to his parents. So to induce him to do this, they added that they knew or were satisfied that Jesus was a sinner because he had broken their false interpretation of the Sabbath. So as they considered that point settled, they urged him to confess that he had attempted to impose on them. Right, which we know not the case. They're just trying to impose a false narrative here. So we know that this man is a sinner. So we have settled it. He has broken the Sabbath, and that leaves no doubt. And being a sinner is a violation of the law, rejecting the Sabbath, and an imposter, which relates to John 9:16. This man is not of God, because he keeps not the Sabbath day. Others said, how can a man that is a sinner do such miracles? And this is where the schism was, the division among them. All right, so verse 25 now. He answered and said, whether he be a sinner or no, I know not. One thing I know, that whereas I was blind, now I see. So this man, he didn't know that this man was a sinner. The man had just said that he believed Jesus to be a prophet in verse 17. If you remember, verse 17. So by saying that he did not know whether he was a sinner, maybe meant that though he might be a prophet, yet that he might not be perfect, or that it did not become him, being an obscure and unlearned man, to attempt to determine that question. What follows shows that he did not believe that he was a sinner, and these words were probably spoken in irony to deride the Pharisees, or to poke them, jab them a little bit. They were perverse and full of objections, and were determined not to believe. The man reminded them that the question was not whether Jesus was a sinner, that though that might be, yet it did not settle the other question about opening his eyes, which was the chief point of the inquiry. So he goes on, he says, "One thing I know, whereas I was blind, now I see." So this one thing I know, about this he could have no doubt. He disregarded, therefore, their objections. And we may learn also here three things: that this declaration, first, this declaration may be made by every converted sinner. He may not be able to meet the objections of others. He may not be able to tell how he was converted. It is enough if he can say, "I was a sinner, but now I love God. I was in darkness, but have now been brought to the light of truth." The second thing he will know is we should not be ashamed of the fact that we are made to see by the Son of God. He is the one that opens our eyes. He opens the eyes of the blind, our spiritual eyes, to spiritual truth, that he is the Son of God. Hallelujah. No objection or derision of men should deter us from such an avowal, because we all know it to be true. Lest a man be born again, he can't even see the kingdom of God. And Jesus, being the light of the world, he opens the eyes of the sinner. And that was the reason he came. He was a great light in a land of darkness that came in the shadow of darkness. They saw great light. He's the light that lights every man. And we hold to the fact that that light, when he first opened our eyes, shined into our spirits and renewed our spirits. And we were born again and seen Jesus as the Son of God and as our Savior and Lord. And then the third thing is, sinners are perpetually shifting the real point of inquiry. They do not inquire into the facts. They assume that a thing cannot be true and then argue as if that was a conceded point. That's an important point he just made. So let's read that again. They don't inquire into the facts. They assume that a thing cannot be true. So it's beyond their scope of reason. It puts God outside of the box they've placed him in. So they assume it cannot be true. And then they argue as if that was a conceded point, as if their opinion was right, because it's outside of the scope of their reason. But the proper way in religion is first to inquire into the facts and then account for them as we can. So that phrase, "you can't handle the truth," that's where we must come with the facts. Let's just look at the facts. The facts are, a noted miracle took place, whether it be the conversion in your heart, a miraculous healing, you were blind and now you see spiritually or physically, you were deaf and now you hear physically or spiritually. Those are the facts. A transformation happened. How it happened? Well, that's the next point. You can't just go in and say, "That's impossible, so I cannot believe it." That's a closed mind. That's where it said in Matthew 13, they will not see. They've closed their eyes. We have a part in this. We have to maintain our openness of heart to allow the Lord to continue to reveal light in us. The light of the body is the eye. If therefore the eye be pure or single, the body will be full of light. But if it's not pure or single, it'll be full of darkness. And how great is that darkness? If we are clouded, if we've closed our spiritual vision with some other love, a love of sin, a love of money, a love of mammon, we will be, the leading principle of our life will not be God's revelation truth. It will be the sinful passions and darkness in our heart. And how great is that darkness? Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount. We have to keep the eyes, our spiritual vision open, that God's revelation light, the entrance of his word, brings light. God is light. If we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. We have to allow God's revelation light to continue in our lives and not turn a blind eye to it. Just 1 John 1:7, walking in the light, allowing God's light in us. And how does it go? It says in verse 5, God is light and in him is no darkness at all. So friends, stay open to God's light, his which is a symbol of his truth. It's also, he is light in a physical sense, and we are beings of light. We're called the sons of light. But stay open to God's revelation. Stay open to his truth. We live on every word that proceeds out of his mouth. And go by the facts. These men in this healing are tainted. They've closed their hearts. They don't want to know the truth. They only want to convict Jesus of being a sinner. But they're struggling to do it right now. And they are blind. The true ones that are blind are the Pharisees, and they've closed their own eyes. And the one that was born blind is the one that truly sees now. He knows that Jesus did this, and that's enough for him, because no man could open my eyes spiritually and physically unless he was sent from God. So wow, this is an awesome miracle in the physical, and it's also very symbolic in the spiritual. And we're going to see how Jesus wraps this up in the next video. So I hope you'll tune in till then. You're going to see the spiritual sense Jesus makes of this to these ones who say that they see, but really they don't see because they close their eyes. So thanks for tuning in, friends. We're at our end right now, and I will see you in the next video. God bless you till then.